Next, we look into a set of tools that realize these concepts that we discussed. First, we talk a bit about the Spark data model and its architecture. So what is Spark? Spark is an in-memory processing and storage engine. It is tightly integrated into this Hadoop ecosystem, so you can load data, for example, from HDFS, but also from other databases, and you can use the resource management from Yarn, for example. You can use Hadoop, but also Spark can work standalone, and it can run either in local, a single node, which we use for the exercises, or in cluster mode. Similar to Hadoop, it performs task scheduling and monitoring. It has a rich set of APIs for Java, Scala, Python, and R, for example. It allows you to do SQL on top of in-memory storage provided by Spark using SQL. And it has, interestingly, a set of high-level domain-specific tools and languages that give you an advanced API that simplifies typical computational tasks. Spark has very nice interactive shells that tightly integrate into Spark, but also into the programming language. For example, with PySpark, you can work on an interactive Python shell that parallelizes the axes very nicely. So let's talk about the data model underneath Spark. So the basic data model for Spark 1 was a distributed memory model using resilient distributed data sets, or RDDs in short, as I will name them. The idea is that you have a set of data. You can think of it again like a bit like a table of tuples, and these tuples are somehow partitioned across CPUs. Okay, here for example we have number 1 to 1000. Assume this is our data, and I could partition this into 4 partitions, and this is then a resilient distributed data set. And each of these partitions, well, would be hosted on a different processor, potentially on a different node, and therewith can be easily parallelized. So what is the data that, or these tuples that I store in an RDD? It's either a list or it's a key value pair. Our key value pairs stored in a map. Interestingly, you cannot change the content of an RDD. So once you assigned an RDD to certain data, it is immutable and can never be changed. Of course, you will do some operations with the data, but therewith you will obtain a new RDD, okay? Never changing the previous RDD. The new high-level APIs of Spark provide additional representations. For example, with Spark SQL, we can use data frames, which are then proper tables with schematas. As a second option, Spark provides shared variables to which all the processors can access, and we will see into that. So let's talk a bit about the durability of data. As the name resilience suggests here, there must be some kind of durability. First of all, RDDs are stored in memory and they live until you terminate what is called the Spark context in your application. Okay, so if you terminate the Spark application, all the memory is freed, which makes sense, which frees this distributed data sets. Okay, but there is a way to store the data, to persist the data that you have in these data sets. And now the resilience is provided by recording the actual computation history and then recomputing the data if you use some of the data, okay? So if this node that hosts partition 4 gets down, there is a way to restore partition 4 data by going back to the source and reapplying the computation, which is, I find this a really intriguing concept, and you will see in an example how this works. Don't worry. So let's talk a bit more about the operations that we can do with RDDs. So you can create an RDD by parallelizing an existing collection. For example, in Python, let's assume I have the number 1 to 5. I can say SC, which is Spark context, please parallelize my data into 5 partitions, and then I retrieve an RDD. So that was easy. I can also read data from files with different formats. For example, I can read a text file just and saying Spark context text file, the name of the file, and now I obtain an RDD again. So after reading the file, it's basically distributed into different partitions that then are represented by this RDD. Now, how can I transform one RDD into another RDD applying operations? Well, I can specify the RDD, which is an object, and the operation I want to perform. For example, please filter on this RDD the data that fulfills this function. Here we use a lambda function. So we say the data that gets in, so the tuples, if they are dividable by 2, well, this expression becomes true, and then we keep them. So we filter out the odd tuples. So such an operation and computation runs in parallel on the partitions. And the data of these RDDs is typically just stored for a short period of time, intermediately, as long as it's needed. But if you need it multiple times, you can keep it in memory or store it and persist it into files. You can redistribute how RDDs are partitions. So for example, if I say I don't want to have 4 partitions, but I want to have 8, it's possible. With this kind of operation, it's called shuffle. And an RDD knows its data lineage, so it knows how it was computed. So RDD2 knows that it comes from RDD, and this kind of operator had been applied. Right. So therewith you have a fault-tolerant collection of elements, which are either the lists or dictionaries, our mapped data. And you can split an RDD actually in a choosable number of partitions. And as I said, the fault tolerance comes by being able to recompute an RDD from the source. So I can recompute RDD2 by knowing that it stems from RDD and this operation has been applied. So shared variables are a bit more rarely used, but they are pretty much used for two different scenarios. One is that you can broadcast variables, so it gives you read-only access. So I can broadcast, for example, the tuple 1, 2, 3, and then I have access on all the nodes and all these partitions to this variable. And I'm talking a bit about partition here, but what we later learn, executors actually operate on a partition. So we'll talk about executors when we talk about the compute program that performs manipulations on partitions. All right, accumulators are reduction variables. So they are counters that can be incremented. So I can create such a distributed and variable and shared variable, like saying, please create an accumulator, start with 0. And now I can add 4 to this shared variable. And now all the nodes can actually retrieve the value that is inside this accumulator. And therewith you have shared access to a single variable. You can use an accumulator also for more complicated vector operations. We will find here an example. I'm not going into detail. Now let's talk a bit how applications are actually executed. So first, with Spark, we run a so-called driver program. This program has pretty much a main function that then controls the whole execution of our parallel program. The driver program may have sequential parts, but also it typically works on our RDDs, so it has a parallel portion. We will see how that works in examples. So we have this driver program, which is just, you can think of it having just a single Python program like this. Okay, this is our driver, and it uses this Spark context object, which interfaces with the cluster manager to spawn our parallel program, pretty much. So this parallel program gets executed on worker nodes that are under the hood and managed by this cluster manager. And there we have the executor, and the role of the executor is to run tasks. And a task is a unit of work that is processed by one executor. And our program that we have basically consists of a set of operations that we are performing. Like here we perform on an RDD this filter operation, and this filter operation represents what we say a stage, which is a collection of tasks that execute the same code and run concurrently on different data, so on our different partitions, right? So in our example here, when we say please filter the data, well, we run on our five partitions, and all the five partitions run the same code to filter the data, right? Overall, they are triggered by what we call a job, which we see what it is in a minute. So the executor is a process that provides slots, typically one per CPU or two per CPU, to run the tasks, and they execute, they isolate the different applications that you run. So they cannot be shared between applications, but inside the executor you may have a cache that can be shared between the tasks running on the same worker node. So we have our driver, the main program that controls the data flow and the computation, and the executor processes are then spawned on our nodes. These executor processes store and manage our RDDs, and they perform the computation on these local RDDs, typically. So as you will see in our development mode, we will only create one executor, but you can have as many executors as you like in a distributed environment. So now, how do we execute code? Okay, so remember, our driver program may run a simple operation like saying please filter our RDD. How is it able to perform this operation with, in this case, the code here, which is the operation that we want to run, or our condition in this case, on the different nodes? So how gets this code distributed to this executor and to this executor? Well, this is done by computing the so-called closure, which is all the variables and methods that are needed for the execution of a certain set of code. So this code then gets serialized together with the data and sent to all the tasks that need to do these operations. And then lastly, the tasks are executed by the executors on this closure data, which manipulate this RDD data. So here it becomes also interesting, why do we have these broadcast variables? Well, these broadcast variables, they are available on all the executors. So after I've done a broadcast, like here I broadcasted the value 1 to 3, there is no need to send this again with an operation and a closure to a task. Okay, so in this case, Spark is so smart and the execution environment is so smart to know what is data and code is needed in your closure, and only this data gets communicated from the driver to the executors. And broadcast variables, well, they are communicated once to all executors, so they are available a priori, which saves sometimes time. If particularly if you need this data multiple times for different operations, it's good to just broadcast it once. So let's talk a bit about persistence. So the data lineage of an RDD is stored and remembered in the RDD. There is an interesting concept here where we say only a type of operations, which are the so-called actions, they actually trigger computation. And no intermediate result is kept after the action is over. But however, you can decide to cache intermediate results using this cache and persistent method, which allows you to keep it. Spark manages the memory automatically. It has a least recently used cache. And it has various ways of storing data, which I'm not going into details now. So talk a bit about parallelism again. So Spark runs one task for each partition of the RDD. So the recommendation is to create 2 to 4 partitions for each CPU to ensure that the load is well balanced. So when you create an RDD, a default value is set, but you can change it. So I can say, when I parallelize my data, I can say I need 10 partitions. Typically, the number of partitions inherited from a parent RDD. So if you perform an operation on, you know, this RDD, like a filter operation, you will get 10 partitions again. But there is a way to redistribute the data, which are our shuffle operations. And in those, you can specify the number of tasks, which is the number of partitions also for the that we will get for the new RDD. Some actions and transformations that you will see, they contain numtask as well as an argument. So you can define the number of reducers, for example, and the defaults might be sensible or not. You can find out how the data is distributed in the partitions using the glom operation. So here we take our RDD with our values 1 to 5, and we use the glom operation, and we get the result, which we see is an action. So this action now triggers the collection of the data, and now I retrieve this information. So my first partition has no element, the second partition has 2 elements, I have another empty partition, and then 2 more values. Oh, here I have value 1, 2, 4, and 5, okay? But on 5 partitions. So you can see the data is, well, not perfectly distributed, but it's rather well distributed. In Spark 2, we have additional data structures. One is the data frames and one is data sets. So let's talk about the available data structures. So we talked about RDDs. They are available in Spark 1 and Spark 2. These provide this low-level access and transformations like in data flow schema. There is no structure on our data imposed. You have basically a bag of tuples that are schemaless, like a table that has no header. Now we have data frames that extend these RDDs. This exists also in Spark 1. It's a bit like a table where you have a header which defines the name of a column, similarly to relational databases. So here you have a schema on the tuples, but all the tuples remain untyped, so you don't know which data type is a certain column. This allows you to do some higher level semantics and operations like aggregations on top of it. And with Spark 2 now we have data sets which offer strongly typed and also an untyped API again. With a strongly typed API, you can convert tuples individually into classes, which allow you to efficiently encode your data. So you can know the first column is integer, the second column is a data type, or whatever user-defined type. It also comes with some compile time checks for data types, which is really useful to reduce the error potential, because working with low-level RDDs, as you will see, has the risk, easy risk, to make certain mistakes.